Bim, guess what? We're back. My system. I think it's the internet that's rubbish. Even though Virgin have given me a new box and everything, it just doesn't seem to work as well as it did previously, which is really annoying. Anyway, this is part two now, because, well, we had a part one, now we've got a part two. So apologies, hopefully you'll find me again. Because it's annoying. I've got a very itchy ear as well, which is a bit annoying. Anyway, I'll scratch my ear, see when else comes back. Right, where were we up to? Because we were actually flying through this. We've already done the calls. We've already done the Irish protocol. And we've also done Keir Starmer. So we will carry on with the Taliban and burkas. Kier, we're done Kier. He's a hypocrite. allegedly. No, he's a hypocrite. Taliban's, talking of hypocrites, they've said that when they took over Afghanistan that they were much nicer people than what they were previously, and it was all new people who were in charge, and they were all better than the old people who were in charge previously, and it was going to be fairer for everyone, and women could have rights and all that kind of stuff. And now they've said to women, you've got to wear a full burqa no matter what, which is not good at all, and it does kind of undermine, not that we're surprised, I mean, it's a bit like saying that no one saw Putin invading Ukraine or being an evil person. It's like, yeah, Taliban, they're like multiple versions of Putin. And the Chinese government as well, I suppose you could say. But not all people are bad. For example, Paul Heaton. He is the lead singer of the House Martins, if you're old enough to remember them. And the Beautiful South, if you're old enough to remember them. You know, Jennifer, Alison, Philippa Sue, Annabelle, Terrabelle 2, and all that one. And he also was the lead singer of the Paul Heaton band. Unsurprisingly, because it was named after him. Anyway, he was 60 this week, and what did he do to celebrate? He gave £1,000 to 60 pubs around the country so that the locals could go in, celebrate his birthday, and have a happy hour. See what he did there? It's brilliant. I mean, that is something I would love to do if I had that kind of money, which is what I said when I was trying to be a candidate for the election. Which comes second in. I don't know whether I mentioned it or not. I walked 45 kilometres as well, posting leaflets. I don't know whether I've ever mentioned that or not. Oh my God, I'm turning into Dave Wheel. You know he broke his leg in the FA Cup final? Well, not many people know that, unless you've ever met Dave Wheel, in which case. Mm. Talking of which, best keep on with Paul Heaton. So yeah, he let lots of pubs, well, 60 pubs, one for each year of his life, have a happy hour. A grand. I imagine it went on all night, I'll be honest with you. Most pubs, especially on a weekday, not that busy, until word got out. But yeah, put £1,000 under the bar. Right, I've just mentioned Dave Whelan, I wish he hadn't, because last week, and in the vlog as well, I was mentioning, I don't know whether I mentioned this or not, but I was in the local election, and I got second, doing lots of Wickle Me On. You know, like I wrote the leaflet, I designed the leaflet, I posted the leaflet, I sang the theme tune, and all that kind of, and I was doing this last week, which was a parody of what Little Britain did for Dennis Waterman. Dennis Waterman being this gentleman here. And sadly, a couple of days later, Dennis Waterman passed away. You were 59 on Wednesday. Well, happy belated birthday, dotty lady. And it was nice of him as well. Nice thing to do. Oh yeah, that's what I was saying, wasn't it? Oh, let's go back to him. So yeah, basically, Paul Heaton said, you know, have a drink on me and all that kind of stuff. And I said that when I was doing the election, what I was going to do was donate half the fees you get. It's not a wage, it's like an allowance or a salary or whatever. Half of what I've earned by giving it back to the people of the ward. And that was going to be donating to, say, a food bank one month, or having some entertainers go around to a few of the old people's homes one day, another month, or just standing in a supermarket, maybe Heron or Tesco in Pemberton, or even a McCall's, and just paying for some old ladies' shopping. You know, just doing stuff, giving back to the community, and that was the plan I was going to do. So Paul Eaton, you know, he's a multi-millionaire, and he did that. So, yeah, 60 grand to various different pubs. Now, the pubs would have appreciated it as well, as the people who were actually enjoying the drinks. Either way, fantastic. Well, they will do, because we've still got next month, yeah? Next year, so I'll be back. Talking of which, yeah, I was parodying Dennis Waterman, or at least the Little Britain take on Dennis Waterman, where he does everything. You know, he writes the theme tune, he thinks the theme tune, and all that kind of stuff. And I was like mimicking that for what I did during the election, where, you know, I designed the posters, I designed the leaflets, I wrote the leaflets, I posted the leaflets, I sang the theme tune, and all that kind of thing. And then sadly, he passed away, and whoop, there he is, on that side. And what's frustrating is the fact that I've just parodied Dave Whelan. Oh, no. What I need to do, hang on, I've got an idea. Actually, I'll do this next week. I'll just see if the Dave Whelan thing doesn't work. Please don't work. But anyway, yeah. Now, I remember Dennis Waterman first being in The Sweeney, which is the picture you can see. It was that old. Even photographs in those days were black and white, never mind the TV shows. Which was like Rough and Tumble Cops in London. There is actually an element of the Metropolitan Police called The Sweeney. I think they've reinstated it recently, but they can't go around you know, roughing people up, chucking them against walls, chucking them off into docks and just being generally bullies. They're not allowed to do that anymore. But then he reappeared again in Minder, the first couple of series of Minder with the Arthur. He was the Minder of Arthur, who was a con man, basically. And they got into various scrapes and whatnot. And then he was in that show with the old coppers who were looking into cold cases and things like that. And that was the last thing he was in majorly, although he did have some bit parts in other things as well. But either way, a sad loss at age of 74, which was, yeah. And I kind of felt guilty because I'd been parrying him. New tricks, that's the one. I've been parrying him. You know what we're in. Making him into a parody. There you go. And then he passed away, and it's happened before. I can't remember who else with. But I do remember one night in 2016, it was a January, and I went into the wormhole of watching YouTube videos, which is probably how someone's going to find this, and I started playing lots of David Bowie songs for no reason whatsoever. I've not even thought about David Bowie. I've not listened to any David Bowie, but I ended up watching some in the region of about 25 different David Bowie videos. Including obviously Ashes to Ashes and China Girl and you know, all the stuff that I got into, which is when I got into him, which was the Scary Monsters album, but also the back catalogue for me, and my favourite, which is Little Wonder, which was in the late 90s, early noughties, when he did Hello Space Boy with the Pet Shop Boys. He brought another album out which was kind of dancey, and I really love it. And following day I got up, listened to the news, and he passed away overnight. And I'm like, oh my gosh. And again, I felt guilty because I'd watched a lot of his videos. And I thought, it wasn't my fault, was it? Anyway, it probably wasn't. Hopefully. I don't know. Things that are very... a really unfortunate psychic, if true. Well, I've got a plan for next week. I had a plan for this week, but I didn't have time to do it. I will have a plan for next week. I can't tell you who the plan is, but talking of Vladimir Putin, excuse me, I just need to wash my a bit off topic, but have you heard this year's UK Eurovision Song Contest entry? I actually think it's decent for a change. Spaceman by Sam Ryder. No. I saw a clip of it on the news, and it's like the second favourite after the Ukraine, which I don't believe. I mean, Europe 8 the UK, although they might like the UK now because we give lots of stuff to Ukraine, but we've been really nasty giving out visas to people in Ukraine to come here. So yeah, there was an intruder in Standish High School today. Well, that's not good. Ah, well, I think the siren's kicking in here. Anyway, let's talk about Putin while I still can. Putin has aged a lot recently. There, he looks like he's about 96, and it's deliberately out of focus as well. But they had Victory Day, where they celebrate the victory over the Nazis, and they have big parades, and they basically show off all the weapons, the tanks, the nuclear weapons and all that kind of stuff. And there was a lot less than what there normally is, due to the fact that a lot of it's been destroyed. There's a thing up today where the Russians were trying to go over a river, and there's just basically tanks and vehicles all blown up because Ukraine just basically blitzed them. And fair play to Ukraine. Anyway, the leader always has a speech at this event, the Victory Day celebrations, and, you know, celebrating, to be fair, a good victory against the Nazis. The Russians did really well in, you know, combating the Nazis from their front, and obviously we and did the same on this side with the Allies, defeating Nazi Germany as well. So, you know, fair play. And but it's just a way of, you know, bashing the chest, saying, look how strong we are and all this kind of stuff. But Putin did this speech, and he basically blamed Europe for the war, although he didn't call it a war. And he must realise that he doesn't have the power anymore to dictate to the people of Russia what news he wants them to gay. Oh, it might be double, an old double. And yeah, that's a good point, actually. It doesn't really look like Putin, does it? Anyway, Putin has been basically blaming everyone else for what's going on, and actually saying, although he can't claim a victory, but he's saying that, you know, they're doing really well and all this kind of stuff. And you're like, the people in Russia are not naive anymore. People my generation and older, maybe, because they've been brainwashed for, you know, 50 plus years. But certainly, people under the age of 30 know exactly what's going on. They're no ways of getting information and the true information. Although, are we being brainwashed? No, I don't think so. And it just seems like he's living in the 1970s. We're in the 2020s. And I'm just concerned that he's going to do something stupid as a panic. It just terrifies me, basically. Another thing that terrified me this week was Michael Gove. I'll be honest with you, Michael Gove terrifies me all the time anyway. He's just a very, very strange individual. But this week he was doing a interview on Breakfast TV where he was talking about various bits and pieces of what's going on here, there and everywhere. And he started doing these really creepy voices, including a really naff scouse calm down thing. And I'm like, you're a politician. I mean, okay, you weren't in Partygate. I mean, he'd invite you to a party anyway. But you're a senior-ish politician. Okay, you're in a made-up thing, but you're a senior politician. And you shouldn't be doing silly voices on serious news. If you're on Have I Got News For You, or if you're on, I don't know, the Graham Norton Show, or something like that, then fair enough. But not when you're on the news. And people are struggling like mad with cost of living. There's the war in Ukraine. There's Partygate. There's Beergate. There's everything going on. Yeah, Michael Gove, Pratt of the Week. To be fair, you could probably say that every week, Dotty Lady. I mean, he really is a very bizarre person. And I think he did put himself up for election at some point as to be the leader of the Tories. It might have been when Theresa May won, actually. because I think he backed Boris this time round. But he's a very odd individual. I mean, the Tories have got a lot of odd individuals. Obviously, you've got Jacob Rees-Mogg, who's basically, you know, like from 1901, and, you know, a very peculiar person. Don't get me wrong. You've got the Labour Party as well. You've got Angela Rayner, who's basically, you can imagine her outside a pub bashing someone over the head with an handbag. It's politics at the moment is just weird, which I think is why I did as well as what I may have done in the local elections. Did I mention? I was in the... Yeah, I did. Okay, I won't mention it again. Anyway, another weird thing that happened this week in the news was news that EasyJet... This just goes with my mind. EasyJet are getting rid of 6 rows of seats at the back of their aeroplanes. Now, they're the safest seats in the plane, so get rid of the front 6 rows, not the back 6 rows. But they're doing it so they can have less cabin crew to save money. Now, I don't know how much it costs to fly an EasyJet plane, but it's going to cost exactly the same amount to fly an EasyJet plane with 6 less passengers on it, fuel-wise, than it would do otherwise. Whoever is the person that they're going to get rid of from the cabin crew, that's one wage. But surely the 6 seats, if occupied, would be more than the one wage and would add to the fuel, the cost of the fuel and the maintenance of the plane. So taking 6 seats, 6 rows of seats out, whatever it is, makes no economic sense. Because surely those 6 people or 6 rows of people are going to pay more, even if they're on a 20 quid seat, than what the person's going to earn who isn't on the plane as staff. I'm like, what? I don't get it. Another thing as well about planes is, and this is something else I don't get, is why they don't have a technique on them where they can drop the seats out the bottom of the plane with parachutes on for when the planes are crashing. Gives you more of a chance. The seats drop out the plane, but they've got parachutes on, you've got your seatbelt on, you float down, and you've got more of a chance of surviving. But anyway, it doesn't make ecological sense either. No, it doesn't, because there's a number of people can no longer get on that plane, so they have to get on another plane, so you have to have another plane, which is more expense. So it just makes no sense whatsoever. But, as I've said before, we'll never have electric planes. What we need is hydrogen-powered planes, so Rolls-Royce get on with it. And what we also need is hydrogen-powered cars, because there's now becoming a shortage of the stuff that they need to make the batteries, because they mine it out of the earth, which defeats the whole object of the in things anyway. Electric vehicles? No. Anyway, that's EasyJet's logic, which we like. Now, a lot of people whinged and mourned when Doctor Who became a woman. Now, I wasn't bothered about Doctor Who being a woman, because Doctor Who isn't a human. Doctor Who is an alien. Doctor Who could come back as a dog. It could come back as a bug-eyed monster with 15 arms. Doctor Who, the character, is not a human. So male or female is irrelevant. What I don't like, and I've not liked, I've been a fan of Doctor Who since I was a kid, went off it. Controversial, I went off it when Tom Baker came on, but more so after Tom Baker. I never watched it again after Tom Baker. Helix cars are arrogant and inefficient vehicles, investing more in fencing bikes and public transport, which is what I said on my things. I actually read Helix, as in, that's what you were saying. I'm like, what are Helix cars? No, hiya Helix. Cars are arrogant and inefficient vehicles, investing more in bikes and public transport would be much better. The only problem is people don't want to ride bikes in Britain because the weather is crap. So public transport, that's what I was going to get at, a dotty lady. It's the writing I've been objecting to. I thought Peter Capaldi was brilliant as a doctor. When the Doctor Who came back with Eccleston, I didn't watch it because it was Doctor Who and I thought it was crap. Then I caught half an episode of Tennant And I thought, actually, this is really good. And it's Russell T Davies who was doing the writing. He's the one who brought it back. He was the guy who did Queer as Folk, Cucumber, Banana, and various other bits and pieces as well, including doing what was it called? That AIDS thing he did. It's a Sim. He did that as well. Brilliant writer, absolutely amazing. But he quit years ago to pursue other things, which is fair enough. And now he's back, and it's the big anniversary of Doctor Who and all that. So now we've got this gentleman here, who is going to be the new Doctor. He's been announced. It looks like he's already got his costume on, to be fair. A bit bare-chested, but, you know, you got it, flaunt it. He wasn't, though. This is just him at the BAFTA Awards, so you always dress up for them. He's called Gatwa, Nikui Gatwa, which you can't say it. The last few years have been bad. There was one episode where I actually cried, and that was the Rosa Parks one, which is where they're on the bus, and it was actually the bit where they're on the bus. Shooting Gatwa. Okay, then. Thank you, Helix. I appreciate your timing of coming in. It's brilliant. But it feels like the box ticking's going on again. And I've nothing against box ticking, but I think sometimes it goes a bit too far. Because this guy ticks a few boxes, shall we say. Which isn't an issue. Like I say, it's an alien. It could be a dog. Could be a rabbit. It doesn't really matter. But it just feels like we're just ticking boxes at the minute. It's not just Doctor Who. They're doing it on loads of things. And it just feels like we should have characters like Black Panther. Amazing film, so I've been told. Not seen it. Not watched any of the Marvel movies. But stuff like that. Why can't we have characters that are of the ilk that people want everything to be? If you get me. I'm not being racist or anything. I'm just saying that we could. Why haven't we got characters that are not? I mean, like, look at Luther, for example. You know, strong character. And there are other characters as well. But we seem to want to change everything to fit what is perceived now in society as being what it is. And I'm not necessarily disputing that. I just hope, though, that the writing's better. I mean, Russell T Davies is fantastic. And if you look, I ended up going back to Eccleston and watching all them as well. And there's references in the early Doctor Who's. Yeah, I agree, Helix. Having seen interviews and his other roles, where are we? Where it's pronounced Shooty. Shooty seems perfect for the Doctor. I've always said that Iwan, I don't know his surname, but he was in Game of Thrones. He was in Misfits. Simon in Misfits, and he was in that comedy with the two gay guys, the old gay guys who lived downstairs, and he kept popping in every now and then. And I think he'd make a really good Doctor as well, because he can do many things. He's, you know, he can be sensitive, he can be action, he can be comedy. And I think that's the kind of person you need in the role. But you need the writing to be good. It doesn't matter who's playing a character if the writing's crap. I mean, you know, you watch soap operas, you might be a big fan of, I don't know, Hollyoaks. I've never watched a Hollyoaks episode in my life. I've no intention of doing. But there are people in that who can't act for toffee. Everyone says so. And I often joke when I do my acting things. It's one of those things where I always say I'm nearly good enough to be in Hollyoaks because, you know, it's pretty naff. But if the writing's good, it doesn't matter who's doing it. If the writing's good and the editing's good, then you can make people look good. But it doesn't matter how good you are if the writing's rubbish. Peter Capaldi, I thought, was an amazing Doctor. One of the best lines was in one of the worst ones. And that was where they'd been miniaturised and they were inside a Dalek and they were at one level and he had to go somewhere within the Dalek to do something. I can't remember what it was. And the companion at the time, he suggested, went up and spoke to the blob that's in the top of the Dalek and reasoned with it for whatever it was doing. And the companion said, well, how am I supposed to get up there? And he looked at her and went, you're a clever girl, you'll figure it out, and ran off. And I thought, wow, that is brilliant. I mean, the fact they're inside a Dalek is absolute, you know, bull. But the actual character, and this was early on, was really, really good. I didn't like him playing the electric guitar, but I like the eccentricity of it all and everything. And, you know, the previous Doctor has done a bit of that. And this new Doctor, like we said, is a multi-talented actor, so we'll no doubt be able to do all that. And with Russell T. Davies, this could be the best Doctor ever. We don't know. It could be the best Doctor Who series ever. But the next Doctor will be transgender. Yeah. I mean, again, I don't know how that would work with an alien, but, you know, let's go with it. I have no issue. And someone asked me in the election, you know, what's your opinion on transgender? And I'm like, I don't care who you are. I don't care who you recognise yourself as. You should be able to get on with your life as whomever you choose to be, but without preference or without negativity put at you. You should just be treated, everyone should be treated the same. And that is the way forward. It doesn't matter whether you're, you know, from any country in the world, any religion, anything at all that you want to be, you can be. But don't rub it in our face and don't expect favours from it. You're the same as us. At the end of the day, you know, we are all human. No matter what you recognise yourself as, you're still a human, which technically is an animal. We're all animals. So we should all be treated the same. And that is the way it should be. And that's basically what I answered. Not a lot shorter than that, but I mean, I'm trying to kill time here. So, but anyway, yeah. I want to be a unicorn. Well, you can recognise yourself as a unicorn, but you'll still be a human. But I mean, if you want to recognise yourself as a woman or a man or whatever, that's fine. I have no issue with that whatsoever. I have no issue with transgender. I have no issues with any sexuality. I have no religion. No issues with any religions. Personally, I'm atheist, which means I have the same opinion on all of all religions. You know, if it gives people comfort and people get solace and from believing in something, then that is fine. I want to be jobless. I hate working. Well, I am jobless, and I want to be. Yeah, anyway, that's Friday 13th. We're not going there again. Anyway, so yeah, that's the Doctor Who and my thoughts on Doctor Who. I've gone completely off kilter here. There are a couple of things that I'm really not interested in, but I still have to bring them up. I mean, I don't care. I don't care. Why is it in the news? I'm not even going to say the names. I know who they are, but I'm not going to say the names. All I'm going to say is this is what humanity's got to. Maybe we need more Putins, because this is the most pathetic thing ever. Really, really is. I mean, wags at war. Yeah, Waggate. It's just so pathetic. It's so. I don't care. I really don't care. Talking of not caring, Amir Khan has announced he's retiring from boxing. From his house in Dubai. He's done alright for himself, hasn't he? Do I care? No. Never liked the guy. I think, though, to be fair, you've got to be big-headed. But he makes Lewis Hamilton look modest. Mind you, Lewis Hamilton probably couldn't punch his way out of a wet paper bag. Handbags of 10 paces. And something else I really don't care about, but I'm expecting to hear a very loud groan, is EA no longer doing FIFA. I don't care. What amused me, though, and I heard this on the radio, was that someone from FIFA said, EA are going to carry on making football games, soccer games, but they won't be called FIFA because the license is just too ridiculously expensive because FIFA are just greedy so-and-sos. So you're probably going to get Manchester Red, Manchester Blue, Liverpool Red, Liverpool Blue, a bit like what you did when International Superstar Soccer first came out, which will probably get the license, to be fair, because they're the only people who make soccer games to the same number as FIFA. However, everyone tells me that Pro Evolution Soccer is rubbish compared to FIFA. But EA are going to carry on making football games, but the license is going to go somewhere else. So one would imagine that the FIFA games are going to carry on as they are now. FIFA's going somewhere, but football games by EA ain't going anywhere. So what a guy from FIFA said is, it doesn't matter who makes the FIFA games, they're going to be the best football games out there. I think that's very naive. But like I said before, that's the only reason I put this on here, because that just shows the arrogance of FIFA, and it's just so annoying. So annoying. Sadly, the predatory microtransactions will most likely remain on both the FIFA and the EA Sports games. That is right, Gigaroy. You're new as well. Hi, Gigaroy. Evening, Elder. I'm very well, thank you. Any. So I've got a few new names in today. Don't forget to subscribe so you can catch up with these every week when we do them. I do other live broadcasts as well, usually playing games or whatever, which I'm trying to build up on, but I'm watching a lot of telly at the moment. I'm really into, because I'm old, I'm really into Yesterday Channel and Architecture Railway, Building Underground, Secrets of London Underground, just stuff like that. I'm sorry, I'm just getting old, is what happens when you get old. I'm over it. Another thing I don't give a monkey's left dangle a bit about, already subbed, brilliant, it was in the news, and it's a TV programme, and I don't care. The Queen has been on the throne for 70 years. Bravo, well done. Yeah, showing my age there, exactly. With the yesterday, not applauding the Queen. And I think the Queen and the Royal Family have a place within our culture, because it does bring lots of tourists over. If you ever go to London and you go to Buckingham Palace, or you go to Windsor or whatever, it before the pandemic, it was just full of tourists from all over the world, and that they spend money, so it kind of makes sense. And they actually more money spent from tourists than what it costs us to have the royal family, so they actually make money as well. That's beside the point. 70 years, well done, bravo. They come up with a pudding for her. There was various cakes and stuff, and it was in the news yesterday before it had happened, and I don't care about making a pudding for a woman who's probably never going to eat the bloody thing. And they said, well, we've done it before. We did the Victoria sponge for, I assume, Queen Victoria. And then we did the coronation chicken. Now, have you ever had coronation chicken? It's vile. I don't mind a Victoria sponge every now and then, or too many carbs. But coronation chicken, I'd sooner rub it in my eyes than eat it. And this trifle looks exactly the same. But I don't care. If you want to make a trifle, make a trifle. If you want to put it on telly, put it on telly. People love the Great British Bake Off. That's fine. Doesn't need to be in the bloody news, though, does it? Oh, fuming. Absolutely fuming. Oh, Elder getting assassinated after this. Yeah. Something did amuse me greatly this week, though. I was very, very amused by this, and it's only a picture. I've not seen a video of it, but you know, if you've ever been driving, or on a bus or walking, and you see an articulated lorry, and it's manoeuvring into somewhere. I mean, I've seen a few in Hyde in particular, where there was a supermarket where the loading bay was at the back of the supermarket, but the supermarket was kind of made out of. They knocked down a few terrace shops and put a supermarket there. It was only a little supermarket. So this lorry had to reverse into an alleyway, which was about 2 inches wider than the lorry. And they do it all the time. And I was like, oh, that was amazing. You know, I mean, you know, you think all lorry drivers are absolutely amazing. And then you see this. Tesco lorry tried to make that turn forwards. Now, to be fair, probably could have done it backwards, because it's easier to reverse into spaces. That's why when you parallel park, you drive next to the car in front of you, and then you reverse into the space, rather than driving in nose first, because steering and all that kind of stuff. That lorry was stuck there for 6 hours. completely, I mean, it's only a small town it was in, but it completely gridlocked the whole area. Because it, and you're like, absolutely fantastic. The moment you know you've effed up, yeah, absolutely. Hi, David Reed. Jodie was a good actress, just didn't work. PC issues rammed down our throats with Chibnall. Yes, David, that's what we were talking about. It doesn't matter how good the actor is or isn't. It's the writing. And we did get a lot of PC stuff. And people switch off on that. And I think that's one reason why they brought back Russell. Because, well, to be fair, he does do a lot of PC stuff. So, but he does a lot of edgy stuff. So it might make it a bit better. And welcome as well, David. If you haven't already, don't forget to subscribe. So yeah, that amused me no end. That was probably the funniest thing I've seen this week, is that getting stuck. And it looks like you can't really do anything with that wall because it looks very thick where it's at. And they couldn't get it out. They couldn't reverse it. They couldn't get it forward. It was there for 6 hours. And yeah, hysterical. Love stuff like that. Something else that's amused me a little bit this week, oh well, impressed me, let's be honest, is the guy on the right landed an aeroplane. If you're upset with PC issues, you haven't been paying attention to Doctor Who's nearly 60 years of left-wing political alignment. Wow, that was deep. Yeah, the guy on the left landed a plane. Now, nothing unusual about that, apart from the fact he was only a passenger on the plane. It's the little plane you can see to the left of him, and the guy in the aqua shirt, not the Barbie girl, the colour aqua, well, they're both baldy, the one with the lanyard on, he talked him down, very much like Airplane the movie, which is one of my favourite movies of all time, Airplane, where the guy has a drink problem, keeps going like that, and Don't Call Me Shirley, and you know, it's all the jokes in there and all the stuff going on in the background as well. And it felt like, when I was hearing about this story, watching it on the news, it felt like it was a live episode of Airplane. Surely you can't be serious. I am serious, and Don't Call Me Shirley. The aeroplane in question wasn't a big aeroplane. It was only a single seater. And I don't believe he's just landed a plane, no experience. He was taught down. To be fair, he looks quite young. He's probably played a lot of computer games, so he's probably got a bit of nous about him. But yeah, it was a bumpy landing, apparently, but he got it down. No one died. Well, we don't know what the condition of the pilot was. He was taken ill. But yeah, everyone else was okay. And the guy who talked him down is an experienced pilot trainer, so it does kind of make sense that he could do it. But still, both of them deserve medals, because that is just amazing. And it's a very good story. I mean, that's something to tell your grandkids, isn't it? Oh, yeah. You know, you won't believe this, but kids, I landed a plane. I'm not even a pilot. Stephen Moffat was Doctor Who showrunner, started Chibnall's PC, was wrong. Oh, we've got an argument going on now. All right. Something else that people have been arguing about, including me in my manifesto leaflet thing, is the Clean Air Zone, which features all of Greater Manchester, including Manchester, Stockport, Tameside, Oldham, Rochdale, Bury, Bolton, Salford, Trafford, and inexplicably Wigan. Now, if you look at the facts and figures, Wigan has never had a problem with air quality for decades. I mean, obviously, like everyone else did when everyone was burning coal, and we had an amazing amount of mines and industry in Wigan, which is before I moved here. It's, you know, it's always been a dirty town, but I've been here since the 90s, and the reason I moved here was because it was so clean and the air was fresh. Anyway, we got dragged into it by our cabinet of eight councillors from 75, from a population of over 360,000. And anyway, it seems now that the whole thing is about to be scrapped, to a degree. As I've said in my manifesto, as I said on my videos that I did, all the vehicles that they are talking about have to go through MOTs. They have to be tested for emissions. If they are able to go through emissions and get an MOT for public vehicles, then they are safe to be on the road. What isn't safe is when you lose the lanes and make them into cycle lanes where buses can't go down there and taxis can't go down there. So they end up being stuck in traffic, which then does pollute because they're not moving. The idea is to get them from A to B as quickly as possible. Plus, now, a lot of taxis have been for a while, new ones, hybrid taxis. So they have less emissions. And a lot of taxis now are coming through and they're electric. So again, complete waste of time. And then you've got the buses, which are starting to come in hybrid and electric as well. And a lot of the buses that are currently on the road will need replacing in the next few years anyway. So it seems the whole thing seemed pointless, which is why I was against it, particularly in Wigan. I get it in places like London, Manchester, Birmingham, Coventry, maybe even Belfast, Glasgow, Edinburgh, where there's cities and there's a lot of people driving around, a lot of people living in those cities, breathing in the air. I get it there completely. I just didn't get it in Wigan. Anyway, it looks like it might be on the way out. Whoop, whoop. So, what have I missed out? I missed out bumbling Boris. You thought he got away with it, didn't you? He thought he got away with it. Hey, Boris, if you're watching, you're probably not, but hi if you are. Boris, this is one of the most weird pictures I've ever seen of Boris. And let's be honest, we've seen him hanging from a rope, waving Union Jacks, wearing a helmet. There he is, rowing the Swedish president or prime minister, I don't know which it is, but the leader on a lake. I mean, who would give Boris complete charge of a vehicle of any kind, let alone one that he has to power himself and has another world leader in there with him? Anyway, it seemed it was something to do with them wanting to sign an agreement, and he basically kidnapped her, didn't really. And he took her hostage on this boat until she agreed to sign that if Sweden get invaded, or if England get invaded, or the United Kingdom get invaded, each country, like NATO, will help each other. She must be suicidal. I mean, let's be honest. I wonder if she's pregnant. He's a very virile man, apparently. So Sweden have signed an agreement now that if they get invaded or their territory is compromised, we will help them out with troops, which will then bring in the whole of NATO, to be fair, even though they're not part of NATO. But this is all because of Putin. And then he went, same day, he went to Finland. Now, we all know the Finnish are very, 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 very vocal about their feelings and thoughts. Kimi Räikkönen, for example. So yeah, the Finns are one of my favourite racing drivers of all time, to be fair, Kimi Räikkönen. Absolutely adore the guy because he's just so like that, but they're all like that from up there. Good driver as well. Anyway, that isn't Kimi Räikkönen. That's the president or prime minister of Finland. And we signed the same agreement with them as well. Now, they have an 800-mile border with Russia. And Russia have now said, because of this, there will be repercussions. Sorry, dotty lady. I don't think... you're all right. I think this president, prime minister, whatever, I think he was safe. I don't think he's pregnant. But he signed a document as well. And he's gone further than that, because they have a prime minister and a president in Finland, and they both said that they want to join NATO, basically to protect themselves from Russia. And Russia have said, that is a sign of aggression, so you will pay for that. I don't understand. Putin thought when he invaded... you told me Hamilton was your favourite. Yeah, he is. I love him. Putin thought when he went into Ukraine that they'd be all waving Russian flags and going, yay, Russian troops, yeah, we're free. And he's just got it so wrong. It's unbelievable. It's brilliant, but unbelievable. It's just a shame. So many people from both sides have had to die for no reason whatsoever. And now he's threatening, indirectly, Finland with the same thing. Now, the Finnish people I think, have probably got as big a kahunas as the Ukraines. And I think Putin would probably be best to leave things alone. But what he's basically done is, he's pushed a neutral country, Finland, into NATO, or trying to get into NATO, possibly Sweden as well, and any other country on the borders will think, well, look what's happened to Ukraine, we don't want that happen to us. We're going to have to go into NATO to get the protection. He's more than shot himself in the foot, that's fair to say. Anyway, so what we covered today, and thank you for chatting as well. That's the whole point of this thing, is that you can actually have a chat with me. So Bumbling Boris hasn't been bumbling, which is good. Unlike the Tesco truck driver, who definitely had a bumble. Amir Khan, no one cares, has quit boxing, he's retired. There's a new trifle that's come along that no one cares about, except for the Queen. See him dressed in orange, if you saw that, you see there on the picture for it. And then, Wagyu, I don't care. I don't, it's private. Just sort it out amongst yourselves. Don't drag us into it. Like we were dragged into the clean air zone, which hopefully now is not going to happen, or certainly not going to happen where people get charged for it. Bad day in the office, that Tesco truck, yeah, just a bit. Good day in the pilot seat, though, for the young guy on the right there in the white T-shirt who landed a plane with no experience when the pilot was taken seriously ill and was incoherent. To be fair, I was amazed he even got the radio working. I don't think I'd be able to do that. The creepiest thing of the week was definitely Michael Gove with his weird voices that he did in this interview on BBC Breakfast. If you haven't seen it, YouTube it. Michael Gove interview, Breakfast Telly this week. Watch it. It's what the hell is going on in that man's head? It's scary. FIFA, another thing I don't really care about, being dropped by EA. They'll still bring out football games, but they won't be called FIFA anymore. Good deed of the week was definitely Paul Heaton, who celebrated his 60th birthday, and 60 pubs around the country got a grand each so that people who go to the pubs could have a happy hour, which probably went on all night and probably still going on now in some of the quieter pubs, you never know. Putin had a party as well, or one of his doppelgangers did, in Moscow. I've got to say, it was nice seeing Putin walk, because I've not seen him walk for a while, but now look at that picture, it doesn't look like Putin at all, so yeah, you're probably right, it is one of his doubles. And he basically said that the war and everything, oh, he doesn't call it a war, it's got nothing to do with Russia being aggressive, it's got a lot to do with Europe being aggressive towards Russia, because obviously it has. The new Doctor Who was announced, Sonny... where is it? Gatwa is the new Doctor Who. And as we said, boxes ticked. And sadly, we lost Dennis Waterman, age 74, who was in Minder and also in The Sweeney, if you're old enough to remember that. EasyJet are removing seats from their planes, so they can have less cabin crew in the plane, which just makes no economical or, as you said, environmental sense whatsoever. That is completely, If you live in Afghanistan and you're a female, you now have to wear a full burqa. If you're a knight of the realm and a former person in charge of the Crown Prosecution, apparently, you don't have to resign if you get looked into by the police, unlike he said Boris should have done when he got looked into by the police. So, double standard. But as a politician, what do we expect? And in Northern Ireland, the DUP on the right are not going to work with Sinn Féin because they don't like the Irish Protocol, which is basically... where stuff is checked from going from England, Scotland or Wales to Northern Ireland, so that once it's in Northern Ireland, basically what we've made is we've made Northern Ireland a part of Ireland and Europe. Like I said earlier, it makes no sense whatsoever why they're doing that, but anyway, that's what they're doing. and then McCall's got saved. But keep an eye on them and see in 12 months' time how many of the 1,100 stores are left and how many of the 16,000 people are still working for McCall's, because we've been promised that everyone keeps their jobs and all the shops are staying open. And that is that. So thank you very much for watching. Huge shout out to a dotty lady, Annie, Halex, David Reed, Gig Groy, lots of new names, which I'm loving. Not that I've got anything against people who are irregular. Toffs TV, JT, Selinka, is that it? Kieran. I think that's it. So yeah, thank you very much for watching. Don't forget, around about 8 o'clock, British summertime, every Friday, we'll do this. And we'll see what is going on. It is good to catch one of my live streams. I do intend to do more, but like I say, I'm addicted to watching Abandoned Engineering and Secrets of the London Underground and toy selling in auctions and stuff like that. And they're on all night, every night. I've got to watch them. I'm over it now, though. Anyway, that's it for this week, for What a Week That Was. I will see you next week to see what a week that was. Until then, I'll be seeing you.